But I want to say that I very much appreciate the opportunity, the invitation to be here to participate in this lectureship. I value so much the congregation here at Spring, her faithful elders, her faithful evangelist, and certainly the members who certainly make this work happen, those of you who stand for the truth and contribute so much, particularly at this time when you have a lectureship and all the work that is involved. And we appreciate you so much. And likewise, I'd like to say express my appreciation for my fellow preachers who are here, who I hold in high esteem, and others as well who might be attending, whether from the community, from neighboring congregations. Appreciate your support, appreciate your interest in spiritual matters. Well, what happens if you click the start slideshow? Does it? Okay. Well, I put together a little slide presentation to go with this evening's lecture. We may not be able to get that going, but that's okay. We have what we need when we have God's Word. But our subject, our assigned topic for this evening is, does the New Testament authorize one church to extend fellowship to a sister church? A very precisely worded question that we'll be looking at in a broad sense as we come narrower and more narrowly to addressing this particular issue. And so let's dive right into this subject, which speaks about extending fellowship from one church to another. Let's first begin by defining fellowship. We see a lot of trouble in the Brotherhood today with regard to understanding fellowship. We have a tremendous amount of fellowship issues, and at the root of many of these problems lies a simple and basic failure to understand what fellowship is. Some think that fellowship equals food. We're going to have a fellowship. That means food, I guess, right? No, that's not what it means. Some people seem to apparently believe that fellowship means being nice to someone. And you might be saying, well, what do you mean by that? Well, for example, I know one brother who's expressing the view to another, or the biblical view to another, that we cannot indicate that we have fellowship with someone who's not in fellowship with God. And this person's response was, so you mean we're not supposed to be nice to somebody? How are we going to win them to Christ with that? No, that's not what fellowship means. You can be nice to somebody with whom you do not have spiritual fellowship. And there are a whole, certainly plethora of misunderstandings with regard to fellowship. And so let's look for a moment at the different words that are used with regard to fellowship. Now, typically, when we study fellowship, we look at the word koinonia, and which is, of course, the Greek word for fellowship, the primary Greek word for fellowship. However, we have an entire family of words sharing the root koin, K-O-I-N, which all help us understand the biblical root or the biblical concept of fellowship. We're going to go ahead and hang that up. Okay. Maybe turn it off and turn it on if nothing else. Shake it. Well, you see, we don't only want to look at one side of the coin here, the K-O-I-N. The fundamental word of the coin family is the adjective koinos. And the fundamental meaning of this fundamental word is common. Some of you who are here this evening are familiar with Koine Greek, and that is the language in which the New Testament was inspired. The idea is that was a common language. It was a universal language that they spoke, and so we have this root being used. And so when we think about common, we think about something that is shared, something that is jointly held. In Acts 2 and verse 44, we're told, and all that were believed were together and had had all things common, that all things koinos. And so the idea that they were shared, they were jointly held. And there are certain possessions, if you can call them that, that all faithful churches and Christians hold in common. In Titus 1 and verse 4, we read, "To Titus, mine own son, after the common faith, grace, mercy, and peace from God the Father and the Lord Christ our Savior." And we find that word being used there for common faith, that koinos faith is being spoken of there. In Jude 3, Jude says, "Beloved, when I gave all diligence to write to you of the common salvation, it was needful for me to write to you, exhort you, that you should earnestly contend for the faith which was once delivered unto the saints." There we have that verse which speaks about our need to contend, for which this lectureship and the good publication is named. But our focus is on what is spoken of earlier in that verse. "I gave all diligence to write unto you of the common salvation." It's something jointly held, something jointly shared. And so Christians share a faith. There are things we believe together. We find agreement. We concur upon those things. We share a salvation. There is a common hope that goes along with that salvation. Those are things that are koinos to the Christian. But then, and so we have that word koinos, but then there is also the word koinonos. And that is referred to those who share what is common. That word can be translated fellow or participant. And so different people share in these things, and this is the word that is used for them. They have then an identity in their sharing. They have an identity in the fellowship which they hold jointly. We read in Matthew 23 and verse 30 the words that Christ uttered with regard to the scribes and Pharisees. As he spoke about the claim that they had made, "If we had been in the days of our fathers, we had not been partakers with them in the blood of the prophets." We would have not shared in that. We would have not participated in what they had done. We would have not had fellowship in that kind of action. And so that joint participation, we would not have been fellows in that. And then koinoneo is the primary verb of this family. And this is defined as to share with someone in something. In 1 Peter 4 and verse 13, we read, "But rejoice inasmuch as ye are partakers of Christ's sufferings, that when his glory shall be revealed, you may be glad also with exceeding joy." And so note then, you're partakers. You are a fellow in this, and this is the verb there. Now we have it kind of translated as if it's three words in the original, but it's actually one word. Ye are partakers. Ye partake by what you're doing. You are presently suffering. You're about to suffer worse. But rejoice, because as you're participating in this, you are likewise going to share in the glory that is yet to come. In Romans 12 and verse 13, as Paul is instructing that church in Rome how to have an unhypocritical love, he says that they are to distribute to the necessity of saints. Distribute, that's that word koinoneo. You are in that sense to have fellowship with them. And so we see, among other things here, that fellowship can be financial. When we think about the things that are shared, the things in which they jointly participate, it says you distribute, you share your finances with them. We read in Galatians 6 and verse 6, "Let him that is taught in the word communicate to him that teacheth in all good things." Now we look at that word communicate. To us, that means to have some type of verbal communication, or perhaps bodily gestures, or perhaps written communication. But that's not the kind of communication that's being spoken of there. We find the word communion embedded in there, which is a synonym for fellowship. And that is that word. And so you are to give to him. You are to give of your financial means to that one that teaches and all good things. And so again, we see there that fellowship can be financial. But above all, as we look at the fact that there is this verb, an action, this tells us that fellowship is something active. Fellowship is something that we do. And so we then have that word that we referenced at the very beginning, koinonia. Koinonia then refers to this general state of sharing and joint participation, involving something common, that is that koinos, involves those who are joint participants, the koinonos, and it also involves as well that verb. Those who do have that close association that involving mutual interests and sharing. In 1 John 1 and verse 3, we read about that state. The apostle of love, John, declared, "That which you have seen and heard, declare we unto you, that ye also may have fellowship with us. And truly our fellowship is with the Father and with his Son, Jesus Christ." And so this is something that you have. It's something that is ongoing. This is a presently existing state, and it is vertical, and that it comes down from God, it goes up to God, and that it goes horizontal as well. You have fellowship as well with us. We are your brothers in Christ. And so those of you who are brothers, those of you who are sisters, we share this association. It is a state that exists. There are also other New Testament words that help us to understand biblical fellowship. There is the word metoke, which means sharing or participation. I invite your attention with me for a moment to 2 Corinthians chapter 6. And I know this is going to be referred to at other times in this lectureship, but I just want to note something in particular from this and helps us to illustrate what fellowship is. In 2 Corinthians 6 and verse 14, we read, "Be ye not unequally yoked together with unbelievers, for what fellowship hath righteousness with unrighteousness? And what communion hath light with darkness? And what concord hath Christ with Belial? Or what part hath he that believeth with an infidel? And what agreement hath the temple of God with idols?" And so we referenced synonyms being used, that communion, that fellowship are synonyms in the English, and we find these basically closely synonymous ideas here referring to the same idea. What fellowship? That's metoke there, that word we just referred to, sharing and participation. Righteousness and unrighteousness do not have that. But then we note then also the word is used, what communion hath light with darkness? And so the word that is koinonia that is used there that is translated communion. And what concord hath Christ with Belial? Or what part hath he that believeth with an infidel? And so that same idea of sharing. We have something in each other. He that believes does not share that with an infidel. And also it says, and what agreement hath the temple of God with idols? And so all of these come together and help to illustrate what fellowship is. There is agreement involved. There is concord involved. There is communion involved. This is that state that exists because of the blood of Christ. When one is born again, he enters into this fellowship. In 1 Corinthians chapter 1, we find Paul addressing the church of God, which is at Corinth, those who were sanctified in Christ Jesus. But he says in verse 9, "God is faithful, by whom you were called unto the fellowship of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord." And so we can then, through our obedience to the gospel, through being born again, we can have that fellowship. One of the great blessings of the Christian life, along with such blessings as worship, along with such blessings as prayer, along with such blessings as salvation, one of the great blessings of the Christian life is the fellowship shared by those of like precious faith. We think about the love that David and Jonathan had for each other, the fellowship that they enjoyed. They found agreement. They had concord. They had a part in each other. And as they spoke of it, they spoke about a love that surpassed that of women. But let's then go on a little bit further, having defined fellowship. Let's look at determining fellowship. Turn with me, if you would, to Acts chapter 9. As you probably know, Acts chapter 9 records the conversion of Saul of Tarsus, the one who had become much better known as the Apostle Paul, that faithful laborer who had labored above all the other apostles. But yet we're told that after he had obeyed the gospel, and after he had been preaching Christ in the synagogues of Damascus, that Jesus was the Son of God, we're told in verse 26, "And when Saul was come to Jerusalem, he essayed to join himself to the disciples, but they were all afraid of him, and believed not that he was a disciple." They did not believe what he was saying. Now, on the one hand, it's difficult to fault them too much for why they weren't believing. It wasn't all of those who were at Jerusalem who were surprised. Remember when he was first preaching there in Damascus, we're told in verse 21, "All that heard him were amazed and said, Is not this he that destroyed them which called on this name in Jerusalem and came hither for that intent, that he might bring them bound unto the chief priests?" And so they questioned these things. Those in Damascus did, and likewise when we're told that Saul was attempting to place membership, as we'd use the term, with a church there at Jerusalem. They said, I don't trust this man. And he was going to try to bring people bound, and we're told elsewhere that he would give his vote for them to be put to death when he had the opportunity. And so when we're told that they were afraid of him, we read in verse 26, they were afraid of him. Most obviously, they were afraid that he was a spy for the Jews, seeking to infiltrate the church. But they also would have had a healthy fear of extending fellowship to someone who is not in fellowship with God. This is a fear that all of us should have. The churches of our Lord must be circumspect in extending fellowship, whether it be to an individual, whether it be to another congregation. As we're told in Ephesians 5:11, "And have no fellowship with the unfruitful works of darkness, but rather reprove them." And it is just a few short verses later that we find the admonition that we are to be circumspect. We're to walk circumspectly. Also 2 John verses 9 through 11. Just warn about abiding in the doctrine of Christ. Again, a passage that will be brought up again in this lectureship. But again, the idea, if somebody is not abiding in the doctrine of Christ, one is not to receive him to his house, neither to bid him Godspeed, not to endorse him, not to participate with what he's doing, because if he does, he is a participant in his evil works. And so that's something that ought to cause us to fear. Because if we are participants of their evil works, if we have fellowship in their evil works, we will be judged accordingly. The brethren at Jerusalem went by what they knew. Now, sometimes that may be all you can do. You talk with the person, you ask him questions. Now, that said, they probably could have done some more investigating. We're told just a little bit later that Barnabas was there. He could have borne witness to him, and he did to the apostles. And we find that he was able to do a good work in Jerusalem following that. We're told in 2 Corinthians chapter 3 and verse 1, "Do we begin again to commend ourselves, or need we, as some others, epistles of commendation to you, or letters of commendation from you?" Now, while Paul had a point here, and of course he was defending his apostleship, his ministry, and his point was to say that he personally did not need a letter of commendation. But at the same time, he was saying others did. There were some who needed a kind of recommendation. And perhaps it might be valuable to talk to others before allowing somebody into the body of Christ, before allowing people to infiltrate the body, because false teachers have often done just that. We think about the Crossroads movement and all the damage that was done by that as they came in unawares and took over churches, and many other false teachers have done similarly. We read in 1 John chapter 1, verses 5 and following, "This then is the message which you've heard of him, and declare unto you that God is light, and in him is no darkness at all." Light and darkness standing symbolically for truth and right, while darkness stands symbolically for error and sin. And such things are not to be found in God. That is, the darkness is not to be found. The error is not going to be found. The sin is not going to be found in Him. We read in verse 6, if we say that we have fellowship with Him and walk in darkness, we lie and do not the truth. But if we walk in the light as He is in the light, we have fellowship one with another, and the blood of Jesus Christ His Son cleanseth us from all sins. Again, we come back to that blood of Christ. That blood of Christ that makes it possible for us to walk in the light. Makes it possible for us to have fellowship with the Godhead. To have fellowship with deity. And so we see the necessity of looking at what somebody is doing. We cannot have fellowship then with error. We cannot have fellowship with those who are teaching error. Again, we think about 2 John 9. Whosoever transgresseth and abideth not in the doctrine of Christ hath not God. He that abideth in the doctrine of Christ hath both the Father and the Son. And so the question that needs to be asked is this person or is this church abiding in the doctrine of Christ? Now, 2 John 9 through 11 speaks directly of individuals. That's what we find being referenced there, but it applies at a congregational level. Why wouldn't it? We find the admonitions that are given for individuals applying to the church. We find admonitions given for the church to apply to individuals. Paul wrote, for example, his first epistle to young Timothy for a purpose. He spoke about his desire to come to him, but he said, I'm writing it unto you, that you might know how you ought to behave yourself, how to conduct yourself in the house of God, which is the church of the living God. 1 Timothy 3, verses 14 and 15. And so Paul was instructing the church as to how it was to conduct itself. Yet one finds instructions that would at first at least seem to apply primarily on an individual level. In 1 Timothy chapter 1, in verses 18 and 19, we read, this charge I commend unto thee, son Timothy, according to the prophecies which went before on thee, that thou by them mightest war a good warfare, holding faith and a good conscience, which some having put away concerning faith have made shipwreck. Is not the church to abide by this teaching, by what is said in these verses? It most certainly is. And the instructions that are given to the church collectively are given to the to individuals as well. But so like, then we see the need to determine fellowship. When one looks at an individual, when one looks at a church, just like the church at Jerusalem was looking at Saul, you might think about the fact that they failed. They failed to see some things, but yet they were to do something there. Now, one thing that they failed to see and that churches need to take into account is that a fellowship state can change in a second. Christians ought to appreciate that. We've all been blessed by the grace of God. For by grace are we saved. And so that fellowship state can change in a second. We go into the water, sinners, we come out, children of God. That state changed in a second. Likewise, an erring child of God who has gone astray, realizes his error, confesses his sin, repents of it. In a second, his fellowship state has changed. But at the same time, that doesn't mean that we should not do some kind of due diligence to ask some serious questions about such things. But one thing that needs to be understood, again, is that fellowship can have different senses. Hopefully this came across as we were looking at defining fellowship. There is a state of spiritual fellowship that exists between all faithful brethren and all faithful churches. It just simply is. And faithful brethren and faithful churches do not even have to be in each other's proximity for this state to exist. In 1 Corinthians chapter 10 and verse 16, Paul, of course, is writing from far away, and he says, the cup of blessing which we bless, is it not the communion of the blood of Christ? The bread which we break, is it not the communion of the body of Christ? Well, he wasn't present with the brethren at Corinth. Apparently, they would take some issues with the fact that it would be a while before it would come, and he would have to address those things in his second canonical epistle. But yet there was this communion, this fellowship, again that word koinonia. There is this fellowship that exists with the blood of Christ, this fellowship that exists with the body of Christ, even though we're miles away. Brethren who are on opposite sides of the globe likewise have this fellowship. This state exists regardless of whether faithful brethren and churches acknowledge this, whether they are aware of these other faithful brethren and churches. So that is, there might be faithful brethren in Africa and Asia, you know, that none of us have ever met, none of us have ever heard of, but they looked to God's Word, they looked to the Bible, and they found what they needed to do. And so such, they're in fellowship with God. And if we are in fellowship with God, then they are in fellowship with us. This state of fellowship, it certainly is not determined by us. That state is determined by God. Again, all enter it when they obey the gospel of Jesus Christ, and all who remain faithful remain in this fellowship. They remain in the state. And no other man or church has the right or ability to add a person or a church to this state of fellowship, nor to remove a person from this state of fellowship. In John 10, verses 28 and 29, we find a passage that is sometimes used as a sugar stick of the Calvinists and those who believe in the perseverance of the saints, once saved, always saved. But what it teaches, as intended by our Lord, is certainly true. He says, "Neither shall any man pluck them out of my hand." That is, those who have that, who he's going to give eternal life. He says, "Neither shall any man pluck them out of my hand. My Father which gave them me is greater than all, and no man is able to pluck them out of my Father's hand." Only one's own rebellion can remove him from the Father's hand. Only one's resistance to the Word of God can remove him from that state of fellowship that exists. As we understand that no church or Christian is the ultimate arbiter of who is in fellowship with God. But at the same time, churches are expected to make judgments. It is required that they make judgments. In 1 Corinthians chapter 5, Paul would speak to that church at Corinth of their failure to make a judgment with regard to somebody who is in their midst. And they were to judge those who are within. And in the following chapter, it goes on and speaks about their need to judge within the church and that they were failing to do so. He would say, "Do you not know that the saints shall judge the world? And if the world shall be judged by you, are you unworthy to judge the smallest matters?" Well, then, is not a church capable of looking at matters, looking at an apostate church, and deciding we ought to have fellowship with them or we ought not to have fellowship with them? Look at their bulletins, listen to things that they're saying, and examine their fruits. Churches are expected to make judgments. No, not to judge according to the appearance, but judge righteous judgment, determining fellowship. Let's then look at delivering fellowship. There are those expressions of fellowship when we acknowledge the fact that we are in fellowship with another. And what a wonderful thing it is. That's kind of what we find in the relationship between David and Jonathan. When they're referring to their affection for one another, to their agreement with one another, they understood that they had fellowship. Jonathan understood that David was going to take care of his offspring that he would have once he had died. And he certainly did, as he would take care of Mephibosheth. That would be a lasting fellowship that the two would have, even following Jonathan's death. But again, we think about the love that existed between them. And we're told in 1 Peter 2:17, love the brotherhood. Now, we'll love those who are apostate as well. We desire their salvation. We desire their repentance. We desire them to do what's right. But particularly for those who are faithful, how we ought not to appreciate them now more than ever. More than ever. As we see those bonds of fellowship that existed in years past being torn asunder, how we ought not to appreciate those all the more with those that we do have. Cling to those tightly. appreciate the fact that we have each other. Koinos refers to something jointly held. And as long as there are multiple faithful congregations, no one congregation has sole possession of the true fellowship. It's not something that one congregation gets a monopoly on. But as noted previously, fellowship can be financial. A lot of ways this fellowship can be expressed, and it can be financial. And this fellowship may be extended from perhaps one brother or sister to another, from brother or sister to another church, from one church to an individual brother or sister, and it can be extended from one church to another. It certainly can be. That is an expression of delivering fellowship. But not only is a faithful congregation, then, as we're looking at the question that was asked earlier about does the New Testament authorize one church to extend fellowship to a sister church, not only is a faithful congregation biblically authorized to extend fellowship to another faithful congregation, but a congregation is biblically prohibited from refusing to extend fellowship to another faithful congregation. And we stress the word faithful. But again, what a blessing it is to have that fellowship. Let's next look at denying fellowship. There are some who would extend fellowship to those who are not in fellowship with God. And those who would do such sin. There are some who would refuse to extend fellowship to those who are in fellowship with God. And those who would refuse sin. And there are also those who would claim that no one church can extend fellowship financially to another church in certain situations. They'll say, well, if it's benevolence, okay. But you cannot have financial fellowship with another congregation and proclaiming the gospel. This is the doctrine of the antis. We talked about that which has been an enemy of fellowship. And this certainly has the shades of Diotrephes. Remember Diotrephes? He loved to have the preeminence among them. And what did he do? Well, he didn't like it when anybody would receive the brethren, the missionaries, and he would cast anybody out who did. They were doing what was biblically authorized. They were doing what was biblically right, biblically doing what they should have been doing. And Diotrephes said, don't do it. And that's what we find some brethren doing. Our anti-brethren who say that one church cannot financially contribute to another. They have a misconstrued view of what autonomy requires. They seem to believe that involves some kind of violation of autonomy for one church to make a decision. Its eldership makes its own decision saying, we're going to support this good work that these brethren are doing. They said, well, no, they violated their autonomy. Well, how so? Didn't they make the decision? They sometimes somehow see that as violating church autonomy. Again, Diotrephes, shades of Diotrephes. But we look at then defending fellowship. In 2 Corinthians 10 and verse 8, as the Apostle Paul spoke about the work that he'd done at Corinth and how he had been supported in that, he said, I robbed other churches, taking wages of them to do you service. And so he was receiving outside support while he was working there at the church at Corinth. Well, that's in itself somewhat interesting. Now, our anti-brethren would say, well, that's okay for churches to send it directly to them, as long as it goes directly toward the one who is preaching the gospel. But it cannot go to another eldership. It cannot go into the treasury of another congregation, they will say. Well, you put together 2 Corinthians 10:8 with Philippians 4 and verse 15, and you're going to have some problems with that. Again, as Paul is speaking about the preaching that he did, he said, now you Philippians know also that in the beginning of the gospel, when I departed from Macedonia, where did he go after he departed from Macedonia? He went to Athens and then to Corinth. When I departed from Macedonia, no church communicated with me as concerning giving and receiving, but ye only. Now, wait a minute. He said that he had taken from other churches to do the church at Corinth service for his labor there. A plurality, but yet he's saying that he received support, or that he only had communication with a church at Philippi. One needs to understand that these terms, giving and receiving, are, Brother Cone, accounting terms. Giving and receiving. That is, the church at Philippi was receiving funds. And they were then distributing those funds that were going to the Apostle Paul. We don't find the expression sponsoring church arrangement being used there, but that's what we find taking place. We find that they were receiving those funds which were designated for the use of the Apostle Paul, providing things honest in the sight of men, as Paul always would seek to do, that there was this eldership, there was this congregation that was receiving these funds and then sending them onward to them. There is certainly then that authorization. And such good has been done when faithful brethren have joined together in works. So much could not have been done. We think about the tabernacle meetings that took place in Nashville with Brother N.B. Hardeman. Those could not have taken place without the cooperation, without brethren working together. Here in the city of Houston, when Brother Foy Wallace was defending the truth against the error of premillennialism, and he gave his lectures, again, numerous churches came together, some who would later oppose church cooperation, but spoke very openly and glowingly about the cooperation that existed, that these churches all worked together for good. Again, now it's true that there are congregations whose works faithful churches cannot support, but yet we can work together. We can enjoy the fellowship in all its faces. Where there is faithfulness, where are those walking in the light? And so to the question that was asked at the beginning. Yes, the New Testament conditionally authorizes one church to extend fellowship to a sister church. Again, that is under the condition that they are in fellowship with God, that they are walking in the light as God is in the light, that they're abiding in the doctrine of Christ, that they're not bringing forth the fruits of darkness in what they're doing. Yes, then the church is authorized to extend fellowship to that sister church and in any way that that fellowship can be expressed. Thank you.